I'm sure it's almost impossible for you to have reached this point in life and never at least heard something about Naruto. This is its creator, Kishimoto Musashi Sensei. With such an influential story, it's difficult to even think that there was a time when no one even knew his name. And if your name isn't Akira Toriyama, rarely does an author come out of the gates having a success of this level. Everyone has to start from somewhere. And Kishimoto is no different, mainly because with his most recent stories, perhaps many of us have already started to have doubts as to whether Kishimoto Musashi really is such a good author, at least when the subject is telling a story, right? Because I doubt anyone would say that about his art, which is simply amazing. But then, have you ever thought about what came before? Before the fame, before serialization? Yeah, for us to understand things a little more, we need to go back to the past, back on what put the author's name on the radar of Jump Edge. Back to what came before Naruto. Sit down, that the video is long and there are some things that I need to explain so you can fully understand the whole story. If you already have an idea of how Jump works, it's no surprise that Kishimoto started out like the vast majority of other authors, making one-shots. For those who don't know, one-shot is a way for the publishing magazine to see how an author's ideas are received when writing a short story of just one chapter. If it's good and people like it, let's see what this author can do from now on with it. If not, try again until something good enough comes out. Almost all the biggest stories you know started out this way, being judged by others in the industry as just a newbie. Some authors never get their chance at serialization, others take several one-shots to get a good idea right, and some even start a series on the first try, which is not the case with Kishimoto Sensei. He made a total of short one-chapter stories before arriving at what we would come to know as Naruto. Yeah, the reality is that it's a little difficult to know exactly how many he did, for the reason you will soon understand, but for now, let's say he did 2 or 3 before the Naruto series. And since these stories are made for people to see and judge, we have a kind of unique opportunity to see what things were like before everything happened. How was the beginning of someone who is already such an important pillar in the industry, even if his most recent stories tried to challenge this position a lot. So with this base and curiosity to see what came before in the beginning when he was still just learning, that we arrive at the first one-shot he made, which had a great influence from Akira. This was Karakuri. It was published in Nakamago Jump in 1995, the same arm of the magazine that received the Naruto one-shot in the future, and also the one-shot of another little story that you may have already heard of. Yeah, Bleach. And this branch is somewhat smaller than Weekly Shonen Jump, which publishes all the stories you already know, like One Piece and such. But cool, Karakuri. Holy shit, it's Sasuke from Temur! And it won't be just that. In just a few pages of reading, you will fish out some things that you may have already seen before if you watched or read Naruto. But maybe not even that, the opportunity to see how it all started is simply sensational, especially for those who are interested in seeing how stories are made, but also if you have a general interest in these things, anime and manga and such. Because it's very easy for us to believe and think that everyone that is famous has always been famous, and that maybe the person who made it is a genius, and you will never come close to that. I mean, Oda himself had to go through a lot of one-shots until arriving in One Piece, and because the one-shots before the story that made them famous didn't reach a good enough level by default, you won't hear about them in the same way as the best story that the same author did. So seeing all this is really cool, to witness this at the time and see the evolution of the author and of an idea from when it was used by someone inexperienced until it morphed into something memorable, something used with mastery, which is really amazing to think about, right? Karakuri, despite appearances, does not tell the story of the Uchiha clan, but of a world that was consumed by a virus, and the only solution they found to deal with it was to mess with the human biology itself and implant artificial cells in the central nervous system. But the project was hijacked by people with a lot of money, and inhumane experiments were carried out, and super soldiers were created, the so-called androids. However, to combat this new type of being, the defense agent agency formed the 4th platoon of the 14th division, the Karakuri. And of course, because of the title, our main character is a Karakuri. Unlike Naruto, this story really leans into the cyberpunk style, so much that this premise is very similar to the cyberpsychosis. But with that, you can see exactly how that style, that doesn't have much of a temporal sense in Naruto, originated here. The thing about them living in an almost feudal world, but having technology that wouldn't exist at the time. It's as if Naruto had taken the world of Karakuri and merged with ancient Japan. After this premise, the story itself is a bit generic and really nothing special, with a plot that has almost nothing to do with the premise. It only does because the characters presented are used, but a fight in a small, non-technological town in the middle of a forest. It's certainly not the place you expect super soldiers and androids to fight inside the premise of viruses and super corporations that is given. So when you read it, even if you can't point out all the points, you can understand why this story wasn't very well approved by Jump readers at the time. But also, even though it didn't have the opportunity to germinate into anything right away, it was good enough to show that with the right idea and development, this author has potential. Kishimoto Masashi is a name to pay attention to. Here, even in the midst of confusingly positioned panels, drawings that you can't even begin to understand, you can see what would make Kishimoto famous in the future. The character's style, poses that would be improved and used in iconic moments. His skill and potential began to show their colors in Karakuri. Along with what we have already said, several other ideas started here. You can see that even though here we have a freaky Sonic mouse without much sense, this idea of very well-trained military animal companions generated the Ninken in Naruto, that although they weren't used very well after classic Naruto, it was certainly an idea made much better in Naruto than in its beginnings in Karakuri. Here you can also see a bit of the thing of the eyes appearing. There were still no eye powers and things like that, but the idea of the eyes changing to a blood color was certainly a Kishimoto bias appearing there, and perhaps the beginning of the Sharingan. I don't even need to talk about the Uchiha's clothes, right? Now it's interesting that one of the main ideas of this one shot, which is the main character's Karakuri, is only used in a mega secondary characters in classic Naruto. Despite Dosuke Nuta being really badass, he should have received more scenes, right? But maybe it would be a way to see how small, but also how big Karakuri's position in Naruto's influence was. Karakuri may not have broken the manga environment at the time, but it was enough for it to receive a mention at the 132nd Hopstep Awards in February, which was basically a "Hi, pat on the back, you have potential" smiley face, and because of that, Kishimoto received his first editor, that person who accompanies and helps the development of authors. This editor was Kosuke Yahagi. If you have never heard his name before, it's basically because of him that Naruto exists, but it's still too early for us to talk about that. If you have any other reference that I didn't mention, feel free to comment down there. But soon after, Kishimoto-sensei tried his luck with a few more stories, but he was met with rejection after rejection. Slice of Life tried a story called Michikusa, refused. Apparently kids stealing a wallet wasn't that interesting to even see the light of day. But back to the dancer style, he made Asian Punk, and supposedly told the story of a child who fought using a giant axe against a wizard who controlled ghosts. And it was almost the same axe that cut Kishimoto's happiness and was also refused before the public was able to see. And that's when his next one shot came out and was published. In August 1997, Naruto appeared. The Naruto one shot was very different from what we received in the serialization. The tone of the story is a little dirtier. Naruto here is much more treacherous and vengeful. One of the first scenes is him trapping a schoolmate in a trap hole and then pissing on him. Yeah. Here there is a nine-tailed fox, but it was killed by nine very strong guys, and Naruto is the cub of this fox that the only guy who survived the fight felt sorry for killing. This guy already gives off a Hiruzen and Hagagomo vibe, right? So even though Kaguya Saga was pulled out of the ass at the end of Naruto, something came from here, from the original idea. That's interesting to think about, but anyway. Look, Karakuri Easter egg. Greg, the city is much more futuristic than Konoha, given an idea that it takes place really almost in the same world as Karakuri. Ichirakuramen already exists, and the old guy is the same. Oh, Kiru, the plot here is a bit of a dud. Naruto has to take a guy who blacked out at the ramen shop back home, and the guy is an artist who is retouching a mega famous painting, and the guy to thank him puts the underage boy to drink and the kid goes crazy. He already does some sexy jutsu in the middle of guys he just met. Dude, that's a problem and a half. But then someone arrives to steal the painting. It's surreal to see Naruto and an M1911 on the same page. Bro, there's no way. Naruto is being arrested because they found a pistol in his backpack, man. Help me, man. There's no way he has a motorcycle, bro. Let's go stop laughing. Let's get back to the story. Basically, the plot here involves a lot of the act of trusting a person after suffering a lot for having done it before. It's actually pretty, even though it's a bit rushed, and also for taking place in an environment kind of too random in relation to the story itself. But he uses his fox skills, his legal jutsu, and clears up the misunderstanding of the theft of the painting and the murder of the random guy there that surprisingly had nothing to do with the robbery. I fully expected a twist there. Maybe it was the basis for Kishimoto creating Kabuto, but no, the guy just died. And after all that, Naruto made a new friend, and thus completed the Mountain Chief's task. Yeah, you can more or less understand how this story isn't bad, but when you read it, you understand why it didn't catch on like that right away in Jump, before being reformulated. It's as if there was a lot, the shine was already starting to appear, but it's still as if something was missing, and the story was left aside. And just as it appeared, it disappeared. But even with the magic of us already knowing what will happen in the future, at that moment, for Kishimoto and Yahagi, the story that should be developed to try for a surrealization position was not yet obvious. So at the moment, instead of continuing Naruto, he had three options: either mess with Karakuri, or mess with Naruto, or try to do a surrealization with a completely different story. So at the moment, instead of continuing Naruto as we all would expect, he continued Karakuri, which even had its opportunity to be published in Jump's main magazine. But that's when we start a very big problem that has been driving me crazy in the last few days. The supposed second version is simply impossible to find online, and perhaps in this video, we accidentally found a mini lost media. Here's the situation. The information about this is minimal, and often seems that the sources got confused over the years. When you look for Karakuri, it doesn't matter how, the only thing that appears is the story we have already talked about, but in several places there is some information that says there was a version beyond this. Some places say it was a shorter realization that was cancelled immediately, others say it was just another one shot, but it often seems that people are talking about the 1995 story of Sasuke from Temu as if it had come out in 1998. So everything is extremely confusing and doesn't make sense. If there is only one, then where are these people getting the idea that there was a second version? Is it a case of a telephone game where information changed over time and became something else? Yeah, it could be, but well, after some time researching and trying to understand this whole mess, I found this. Wait, this boy has already appeared here before, right? On what put the author's name on the radar of Jump's editors. But he was met with rejection after rejection. Huh, but it has nothing to do with Karakuri from 1995. This could be a fan art or something. But there are some here that we have already talked about. But there are others that we haven't. How do we confirm this is real? We haven't talked about it yet, but this is from a one-shot that was published in the future. And this is a story called Magic Mushroom that Kishimoto will try to do later, and then we talked about it then. So I'm already going to tell you here that the only character in this image that is unknown is this one? And then, why does this image exist? Why are these drawings like this together? So, the information that people often talk about of having another Karakuri came from these comments by the author. See that it is the same image. It turns out that in the Tankobon, the physical manga of Naruto, Kishimoto-sensei had a small comment section, and there he spoke several times about the bad mangas he tried to make, talking about them and giving several comments on why he thinks they were bad. And it turns out there is one like that for the first Karakuri too. So just from that, we can see that there were really two stories. But this one, in this comment, he says that it was published in Jump, but depending on the way you interpret what he said, it almost gives the impression that this character is part of this character's story, even though he isn't. This mini Naruto with Sasuke's outfit does not appear in the 1995 Karakuri. And after searching for hours, days, and almost going crazy that the information that said there really was a second version of Karakuri was wrong, after a long time searching on the Japanese internet, I started to find some evidence that the second story really existed, in addition to the author's comment. This is the summary page of one of the weekly Shonen Jump magazines from 1998. On this page, there are all the stories that were in that edition. And look there in the corner, Karakuri, and it's exactly the same drawing that Kishimoto put in the comments reading the Naruto manga. And if you are curious, this is the same page, but in the edition that the Naruto one shot came out, and this is from a 1995 edition when the first Karakuri came out. Yeah, dude, there are two versions, and somehow the second one slipped through the cracks and disappeared from the world, even though it was a big part of the story of one of the most important manga authors. But I continued looking. I found some tweets from Japanese people who picked up the magazine at the time and were surprised too. And with these tweets, we reached a very big level in terms of the lack of information that we started this search, because at first I was almost giving up. In this tweet, we have an image, a photo of the first two pages. There it is, that's the character, that's the story, there's no doubt anymore, it exists! And here we solve the first doubt. If my Japanese isn't too wrong, in this part here, it says that it's another one shot by the author. So, yes, even before the story did badly in the popularity vote, like what he said in the Naruto manga, it was already published in the magazine as a one shot, not as a serialization. This sentence here, I'm not going to lie, it's a bit confusing. Talking about two heroes and such, but I don't think it's saying that Karakuri has two heroes now in this version, but rather that there were two one-shots being published in this edition. My Japanese is awful, if you understand better, leave it in the comments if that's not it. But between these two stories, there are 47 pages, so you can get an idea of how much we are missing there. At least 20 odd pages there is, right? Okay, let's analyze this photo a little. In it, we can already see that Karakuri has changed a lot in relation to the first one shot, and we can already see a much greater touch of Naruto than the previous version. The main character, the design, and the way of drawing could literally be placed in Naruto and it would fit perfectly. It turns out that Kishimoto was actually making a version of Karakuri for serialization, but it seems that all of a sudden Jump asked him to make a one shot for one reason or another, and he had to scramble to fit what he had developed into something that had just one chapter, but he did his best. You can also see that the weird Sonic mouse has been replaced by this teddy bear. The main character saying, instead of being Databayo, was Woisu, and the kid is flying on a bizarre chicken, with a gigantic bird getting closer, which you can also see in the designs of Pain's creatures in Naruto Shippuden. He tells the chicken to let the animal pass by, and the boy is more interested in the size of the animal's poop than anything else. Okay? After seeing Naruto pissing back then, maybe that's not very surprising, right? And the teddy bear's name is apparently Ken Ken. From this alone, you can see that the style of the story is much lighter and more shonen-fied than the first version. Shonen Totomoni Jidai Hajimaru, the era begins with the boy. But okay, now we have confirmation, without a doubt, that the story existed. It's there inside the 1998 magazine towards the end of the year. Now we just have to find it. Twitter of the guy who posted the image of the first pages. Look, he found found the first Karakuri too, but beyond that, nothing. Things in this branch of the search have already cooled down. Okay, I found one more photo of the front pages, and they were shown at a Jump exhibition in March 2018. So there were things about more recently, we are getting close. But there is a link, but it broke at some point since 2018. There's nothing more about it in this account either. After some more time looking, always, images from the first page. It's just to confirm that it exists, and that you can't have the rest. This thing is here, teasing me there, and I can't get to it. When the website no longer exists or does not open because of my physical location, the listing only has a few images from the Jump magazine, and Mr. was shooting Notorious B.I.G. in 1998, cool, but I don't wanna know about JoJo now.
No, the SSD is full. I'm recording as long as it holds. This site again? Yeah, one of the few that opens when it's not like Amazon. What if I search here? Oh, there's something. This one can't be for sure, right? And the price isn't always as absurd as what I have been seeing around. Let me see all this. I can already see that it's just going to be the summary. This legal face is already teasing me all the time, bro. Yeah, nothing. These Rurouni Kenshin posters are so cool. Such a shame that the author... Well, there she is again. Even here they say it's a one shot. Oh, wait. Shit, look how many. Oh, it's over. But look at this, I found it, bro. I found it. That's not everything, but holy shit, what time is it? 3:30 a.m. I found it, bro. How about the rest? No, just summary. Look, it was an image of the first page, but that's all too. Amazing clock. Damn, man. Yeah, after that I really had to go and sleep. But now that the hype of finding it has passed, I can't think properly about what happened there. How lucky that the guy put so many photos of Karakuri, even though he was selling a Jump magazine with several other stories. But the reality is that we still have the same problem. We still don't have the whole story, just this half a dozen images. After searching a little more, I found this other Jump magazine ad from the time, on the American eBay for fucking $250, almost double the price of the other site. But the images are literally the same, maybe it's the same person. But the one on eBay is from Yokohama, and the one on the other site is from Osaka, so I don't know what's going on there. But in any case, there are no more images of Karakuri. In reality, on eBay there is one less. This one is not there for some reason, but at least we managed to find something, right? It's something, it's not everything, but it's something. So if it's the only thing we have for now, let's see what happens on the pages, and let's see what we think about this story and how it fits into Kishimoto Sensei's legacy. First of all, these photos are not in sequence. There's stuff from the beginning, the middle, and even the last page. They aren't pages 1, 2, and 3, so things are a bit difficult to understand. Let's start with the first. You can almost be sure that this is the first one, because on the opposite page is just advertising and some other random things, and also because the title is right there, right? Unlike the first Karakuri, we don't have an extensive information dump at the beginning, and we start flying on the chicken of that double page image that we found some time ago. The year is 2000XX. The quality is kinda bad, so it could be 2800, 2600, or 2900, but I think it's just was 2000 or so. In the first Karakuri was 19XX, so that also changed, although the idea was the same, because the magazine that the second Karakuri came out in was already preparing for the new millennium. But whatever, the quality of the first panel, even putting through Waifu 2X, is almost impossible to understand the kanji. But from the broken hiragana that you can read, it's talking about 5 people who did something great, okay? Maybe referring to the Karakuri group? The boy is there talking about corn with the chicken when the shadow appears. A giant creature covers the sun above them. Wasuge! So from the context, I understand that the double page introduction to the story that I found all the time is not the first page, it comes after this one. Interesting. Now there may be another page between that double page and this one, but seems like that this is at the very beginning as well, because this one is that giant bird from above. Then this guy appears flying through the sea and he stops on top of the bird that is flying over a city, and the guy looks like he was looking for it. His poses are very Naruto-like, there's no way. Maybe the design a little less so, but he prepares his arm to attack the animal, and could he be a Karakuri? It's more like a new version of androids perhaps, because he comes with a hurried talk and talks about humans as if he weren't one. I mean, he's flying, right? There's the protagonist flying under the animal's hole and thinking about what would happen if a poop came out at the same time, and bang! The guy who was flying up there is the animal that shits itself everywhere. What in tarnation is this story, bro? Then in the city below, that you can already see a lot of similarity with Konoha's architecture, even more so than the first Karakuri and the Naruto one shot itself. There's a guy playing the violin in the street and he notices a noise from above, as if no one had seen a giant bird with 4 wings flying over the city before it took a beating, right? But anyway, the next page we have is not the next one, but the violinist and the protagonist are together eating and talking about the guy with weird glasses who attacked the animal. So we assume they fought a bit there and something happened. The violinist's name is Brown and the boy's name is Satsuma Kiru, who is the same name as the previous protagonist. The guy was already waiting for something to happen, but Kiru has no idea what's going on and apparently he blacked out after what supposedly happened and doesn't remember anything. The guy says the city is screwed because 2 months or more ago, that weird guy did something that the quality of the image didn't allow me to understand, but it was very serious from the reaction. And it doesn't matter if it was men, children or women, they were all killed. And there was some talk about leaving the city and humans making mistakes, and when that happens his friend says he had to make amends. I didn't understand anything because a lot of talk can't really be seen. After this page, now it's a little difficult to understand what would be the next one of the others that we have, but I believe it's this. It can get a little confusing because this scene with Brown could be after the next 2 pages that we have now, or even perhaps before the conversation in the house that we just saw, but I think it's now. Anyone who is fluent in Japanese must be already be wanting to choke my head out by now, but calm down guys, I try. There was some serious destruction after the fight and Brown is taking the people to the hospital. Once there, he tells Kiru that he's going to his wife's house, which they probably must have talked about at some point before this part, and asks him to come along because the place they are is very dangerous. Kiru refuses, but you can't read why. But it's enough for Brown, who understands the boy's reasons and tells him that he can come and visit anytime because they are friends. Sure, I will be able to read what he said there, but it's enough for both of them to get emotional. Look how cute. He mounts the plane and leaves. Kiru eats his Naruto prototype sandals, goes on his way with the chicken to find Kurisu, or Chris. Who is he? I don't know. The rest of it I imagine someone can read, but I can't. Now the next page, it skips a bunch more because here stuff is already going down. I think it's the final brawl and not the first when the animal shits on Kiru, but depending on it could be before the last page too. But I don't think so. This pose you don't even need to think twice about who made it, right? Kigo rips off his sleeve and exposes his karakuri, which is very similar to the old version. But here, he inherited from a person called Giofrido and not from the government. The bad guy already knows this name and is surprised that the kid has some relation to him. On the top, where you can't read much, you can see that they are on top of something, a flying machine. So I imagine it's Brown's bizarre plane. Maybe that's what they were talking about leaving the city, like flying, living really, I don't know. And here we confirm that this guy is an android. Honestly, I would say the old version was cooler, despite being simpler. And the scene looks familiar, right? Anyway, I don't understand what's going on here, but I think he's releasing the weapons from his body. And that thing on his back would be a little cannon, maybe. If you understand what's going on in the corner, maybe you will understand. We don't have the next page, but assuming that this would be the sequence, the next page would be this, because here it's already at the end of the fight, and the power that the boy uses is called Machine of Destruction. In an alternative world, the children are all shouting "Kikikaikai" instead of Rasengan. The android is surprised by the boy's power, and the boy sends that shonen speech. I inherited Jill's will, and I don't want you or anyone else to feel the same. Don't ask me what feeling he's talking about. And finally, the last page we have, and the last page of the story. I imagine Brown asks Kigo to stay, but Kigo refuses and replies that he's already fine as he's well accompanied. He has Ken Ken, the teddy bear, and Pisuke, the chicken, as well as his right arm. And everything is chill, there's no need to worry. And then he says that the old man is no longer alone. Man, I'm as confused as you are. But he says goodbye. Our time together was short, but it was fun. Goodbye! Then at the hospital, at Kigo's command, this girl arrives who I imagine to be Brown's wife, who calls her Catty. And everything ends well. Whatever exactly happened previously to end well now, right? I could be misunderstanding, but I think Ken Ken talks like the mouse in the first story. Then the story ends with him flying on Pisuke, going after another giant bird anus. Huh? But based on what little I managed to find, you can see that the story was much more developed than the first version. More fluid, better drawings, and the panel positions are much better. Kishimoto basically applied a shonen brush stroke to the first karakuri, and that's what came out. Kigo became much younger and happier. We couldn't see if he could easily get lost. The mouse turned into a teddy bear, and the chicken appeared. The plot of the little guy and the girl being kidnapped by a guy to take her blood became Brown's plot. That even though we couldn't see much of it, you could see that it was much better done and with more personality than the first story. Now, what has changed a lot are the androids, right? Mainly in the design, but here they had the tone of intimidation really decreased compared to the Project Shoji and Project Itachi from the first version. But to finalize, although this video turned into a search of the lost karakuri along the way, it's something that is part of history, and it's very frustrating to know that it's there inside this magazine. Teasing you, look, the main character has white hair, really. And there's simply no way for you to see it unless you pay an unreasonable amount of money. Ay, it's really frustrating. If you, for some reason, have this specific magazine, please post it on Twitter or something like that and tag me. Or if you live in Japan, have access to the 4-5 magazine from 1998 of Weekly Shonen Jump, number 1478, or are willing to pay $250 to the eBay guy or less to the Mekage people, you would be doing a big favor to show the mini lost media of Masashi Kishimoto's legacy to the world. I just wouldn't say it's really a lost media, because besides us knowing that it exists, we know where it is. And there are certainly still many people in the world who have this source that allows us to see the story as a whole. Karakuri 1998. If it's found after this video, I promise to make a video later, okay? But for now, that's it. The new version of Karakuri may have come to see the light of day in a more reformulated form that we can already see many things from Naruto appearing. But it was just a little chapter and poof, it was over. So yet another situation like this made Kishimoto rethink a lot about whether he should really try to make shonen manga. That's why at that moment he tried to dip his toes on sports manga and tried to make Baseball King or Yakuwo because he played baseball at school. But unfortunately he's not Takehiko Inoue and he was not going to bring the sports revolution to the world of manga, and he was also refused for the reason that it was too heavy for the young people who read Shonen Jump, and probably because the story was a bit lame in that first version. But it wasn't just that, he started another one shot, Magyu, and not the one listening to Mamma Mia from ABBA on the radio. Well, that was bad. Everyone went away after that one. Sorry, come back here. I'm just finishing. Seriously. The story really is called Mario. Good luck finding it to read with that name out there. At least you can find it, right? Unlike Kagakugi 2. But these two stories were abandoned at the time because the editor convinced him to try Shonen one more time instead of going to Seinen after the failure of the second Kagakugi. But what came out from this one shot, different from all the others we have talked about from him, you can read them because they were released in 2010 in the case of Yakuwo, which is now called Bench, and Magyu was released in 2013. Beauty, leave Seinen behind. Now it's time to do another one shot. Magic Mushroom. Oh, I like this guy. Yes, this is the one we mentioned it already many minutes ago in this video. But apart from this image and the name that were dropped in the middle of the chapters of the Naruto manga, we only know that the story was about an annoying boy who studies at the magic school and causes confusion over an ancient scroll seared by dark magic. Sounds familiar, huh? But here there was an evil wizard inside. According to Kishimoto, the failure of this story was because of the difficulty in explaining the power system, and since Yahagi had different ideas, he threw it aside and followed his editor's suggestions. Instead of doing another one shot, try doing a serialization now. Kagakugi had already gone down the drain, Seinen out of the question at the moment, and his previous one-shots were so bad that they were never published, so there was only one left to develop, with influences from Dragon Ball, Yu Yu Hakusho, Hunter x Hunter, Ninku, Akira, Ghost in the Shell, and Jinro, said by Kishimoto-sensei himself, the final version of Naruto was born.